What's going on, guys? It is Bernardo, and today is all about getting started with LeafNet password protection for Active Directory. Hopefully, I said that correct because I probably killed it. If not, I'm going to be abbreviating it a lot. And the way I'm going to abbreviate it would be LPP, all right? So let's get right into it. All right, so we're going to get started with LPP for Active Directory. Like I said earlier, I'm going to abbreviate it because I know I'm killing that first word. Okay, so don't kill me. So what is it? Let's go directly to the website. It is a GitHub website, and it tells you right there, LPP is a module that you install on your Active Directory server or servers that use a password filter to inspect passwords as users attempt to change them using group policy. Customize the types of checks you want to perform on those passwords, and they are either rejected or approved and committed to the directory. That's pretty awesome. Downloading it is pretty easy. So we're going to download the LPP, and this is the website right here. The first website that I showed you guys, there's a link that would take you here. It's pretty self-explanatory. The latest version right now is version 1.1.53. Last time that it was modified was May 7th, 2023. If you scroll down a bit, you're going to see the .exe file, so we're going to click on it, and it's downloaded. Now, it's time for us to install the LPP onto your domain controller or domain controllers because this needs to be installed everywhere, all right? Now, within my lab, I only have one domain controller, so we are going to go into that domain controller. The domain controller is DC01. I am going to open up the File Explorer. Within here, I'm going to go into the downloads folder, and there goes the .exe file. I'm going to right-click on it, and I'm going to run it as an administrator, and it's going to load up the wizard. We're going to click Next here. We're going to accept the license and terms, and we are going to click Next. This is everything that it is going to install: the group policy templates, the password management, enable password filtering, and the PowerShell module. A lot of good stuff, you know, you're going to get. So we're going to click Next here. This is the default location that it is going to, you know, drop everything, especially your store, which we are going to go over pretty soon. Don't worry about it. We are going to click on Next. We're going to click Install, and it's going to start installing, and eventually it's going to give you this, complete it successfully. Awesome. Let's click on Finish. Like I said, you have to install it into all your domain controllers. For me, I only have one domain controller. You need to reboot once it's done. So don't reboot all your domain controllers at the same time. Kind of schedule that properly. Do one at a time. Make sure DC replication is, you know, doing its thing. Your system volumes, all that stuff is working, okay? So on the desktop of my domain controller, I'm going to click on Start. I'm going to click on the power button. I am going to select Restart. I am going to click on Continue, and it's going to restart the machine. Awesome. Now, it is time for us to create a LPP store. Now, by default, it actually creates a store for you, but we are going to create one ourselves. So I'm going to show you guys how to do that. Now, reading up on this, there's actually three options. There's one that's recommended, and I'm going to tell you the one that I did because of my environment, and let's go over the three options. The first option is this one. Option one, each server has its own copy of the store, automatically replicates with DFSR. This is the configuration that's recommended. Each server that has the LPP installed, it has its own local copy of the store, and DFSR is used to replicate and keep the changes in sync. New passwords can be added to any server in the replication group, and the DFSR will replicate those changes to the other servers. Again, option number one is the recommended one, and it's not the one that I did because within my lab, I only have one domain controller. I stress this, do not place the store within the system volume folder. Don't do that, okay? You can create a DFS replication group without having to create a share in the DFS namespace. DFS replication and DFS namespaces can be used separately or together. Now, option two, which is the one that I did, and each server has its own copy of the store. Updates are performed manually. In this configuration, each server with the LPP install has a local copy of the store. This means the store will always be available and there will be no bandwidth or latency issues. The downside is that you want to update the store with new passwords, you need to update it on each server manually. Make sure that the local system account has read access to the store. Now, option three, you know, if you don't want to do option one and two, you got three. Each server accesses a single copy of the store via a file share. In this configuration, each server with the LPP install points to a network share that contains the single copy of the store. The benefits are that there is only one copy of the store to be managed, but the downside is that if the file server goes down, the password filter will be unable to perform compromised password checking. So again, option three doesn't really sound the way to go. It's either option one or two. Option two, you got to do it manually if you have multiple domain controllers. If you do option one with multiple domain controllers, everything is synced up automatically for you. But for me, I did option two because I only have one domain controller within my environment. And for option three, assign the read access to the domain controller group on both the share and the underlying file system so that all DCs are able to read the store. Now, on the desktop of my domain controller, I clicked on start. I located the Windows PowerShell ISE and I right-clicked on it. I went into more and I selected run as an administrator. We're going to do some PowerShell, right? It does provide you a PowerShell module, so take advantage of it. Ah, yes. The first command that we're going to do is we're going to create a directory for our store, and I dropped it into the D drive and I'm going to run this. Bam, it's done. Next one that we're going to do is we are going to import the module of the LeafNet. Hopefully I said that right, password protection. We're going to run that and the modules are imported into this session. Now we're going to do the following command. We're going to set our password filter config and we're going to call out the switch of store path and, you know, add our store. This is the path of our new store. Well, for me, we're going to run this. It's done, true, we're done. Now, because we created a store, one of the core requirements is you gotta make sure that your store has the local system attached to it. By default, it should have it and also read access. So that's what we are going to do. I went into my store, right, my D drive. I right-clicked on the new folder. I went into properties. I went into security. And I just made sure that system has read access, which it does. By default, it should have. Now, next thing that we need to do is load our compromised password database into the store. So to do that, more PowerShell. Awesome. Command that we're going to run is the following. We need to open our store. We're going to use the command of open store with a switch of path and just provide the path of where that store folder is located. Run it. Awesome. Now, next command that we need to do is sync hash from HIBP. That stands for Have I Been Pwned. We're going to run that. Give it some time. Eventually, it's going to start synchronizing the password hash from haveibeenpwned.com. It's a lot. It took a long time. Eventually, what happened for me is I ran out of space. I gave the partition 10 gigs. That was not enough. So I had to increase it to 15 gigs. Once I increased the disk to 15 gigs and I ran it again, the cool thing is that if you see right here, I have 5,132 unchanged. Eventually, it's going to change what it left off or what it missed. And that's why it says 372 changed, which is great. And then everything completed properly with no problem. Now, once you have the database synced up, you are able to update the database and also test the database. What do I mean, update the database? You're able to add custom passwords. So I'm going to show you guys how to do that. So let's head back into PowerShell ISE. Now, first command that we're going to run is add compromised password, and we're going to use a switch of value, and I'm going to add BTNHD1234 into the database. So run it. Awesome. Done. Now to test whether or not that was part of the database and it's, you know, it's compromised, you could run the following. Test is compromised password with a switch of value and whatever password. This right here, this command should give you a true or false. If that password is within the database, it should come out true, which it did.
Awesome.
It is time for us to create a group policy. So it's time for us to mess around with the LPP ADMX files. And this is how I did it. So on the DC, on the desktop, I created a folder. And the reason why I created the folder is because I'm going to copy and paste the ADMX files into this folder, as well as the language files into this folder, because I have a Sentru store that I need to move it over. So I'm going to open up the File Explorer. I'm going to go into the C drive. Within the C drive, let's go into Windows. Within Windows, we're going to locate the policy definitions folder, and let's locate our LPP ADMX files. That's it. I'm going to copy those. I'm going to go into that folder that I created within the desktop, and I'm going to paste those two files in there. Let's head back inside the policy definitions folder, and let's scroll up until we find ENUS, which is the English folder. I'm going to double click inside that folder and locate the language files for the LPP stuff. So select them, make a copy of them, head over to the desktop, and then paste it into that folder. Now it's time for us to move those LPP ADMX files into, you know, well, for me, into my Sentru store. So on the desktop of my domain controller, I right-clicked on the start menu, I selected run, and I typed in /DC01, which is my domain. I hit OK. I went into the system volume folder. I double-clicked on btnhd.edu, and I'm going to click on policies. I'm going to scroll down until I locate policy definitions. I'm going to double-click to open it. Now, within here, I am going to paste the ADMX files of the LPP. And then let's scroll up. Let's get into the English folder. It depends on what you're selecting, but I'm going to open up the English folder and drop the language files of the LPP templates in here. Now, once you do that, it is time for us to create the LPP GPO so you can push it out to your machines. To do that, again, I am within my domain controller and I'm going to click on the start menu. I'm going to open up the Windows Administrative Tools folder. I'm going to locate Group Policy Management, click on that. It's going to load up. I typically like to start inside the Group Policy Objects folder. So I'm going to double click on that and open it up. I'm going to right click on the folder and click on New. Now, the name that I provided would be the following. It's going to tackle the computer configuration node, and the name would be LPP Policy. Pretty self-explanatory. Click OK. We're going to select that new policy. We're going to right click on it and we're going to select Edit. Within here, we're going to go into the computer configuration. We're going to go into policies. Within policies, double click on administrative templates. And then right there, LeafNet. Hopefully I said that right. That's the new policy. We're going to go inside password protection for Active Directory. We're going to go into the default policies because this is where the majority of them are here. 10 of them. Awesome. Now, I can't really tell you what to pick within your environment, but I'm going to show you what I did within my lab. I picked the password must match a specific regular expression. So double click on that, enable it. And the regular expression that I provided, I did a little Googling and this is what I gave it. This right here is basically the end user needs to provide a password that's at least 8 characters long with an uppercase, a lowercase, a number, and a symbol. So I copied this and I pasted it into that. I clicked on apply. I clicked OK. Now, the next one that I configured was reject passwords that contain the user's account name. I double clicked on that and I enabled it. I applied it and I clicked on OK. Now, the next one that I set up was reject passwords found in the compromised password store. This is pretty cool because we just synced so much information, almost 13 to 14 gigs of, you know, compromised password. So we definitely want to take advantage of this GPO. So double click on it. We're going to enable it. By default, the two options are enabled. So all you have to do is just click on apply, click on OK. And that's it. Those are the only three that I enabled within this GPO. So I closed it and I'm going to apply it within a particular OU. I'm actually going to apply it to my workstation's OU. I selected the workstation OU. I right clicked on it and I clicked on link and an existing GPO. I selected our new GPO and I clicked OK. Now, time for us to test it, right? You got to test it out. So I actually went inside my Active Directory. I had an end user called Bruce Wayne. I know I reset his password. I gave him the new password. When he logged in, he basically got this. The user password must be changed before signing in. So he clicked OK. He gave the old password, the 10 password. He gave his new one. He confirmed it, but he got this: unable to update the password. The value provided for the new password does not meet the length, blah, blah, blah. So eventually he got it through. It worked. But the cool thing is if you head into your domain controller and you load up the event viewer, you're going to see a couple of new event IDs. One is 4 and 5 for what I've seen. There's probably other ones, but 4 for the LPP is actually the processing a password change request for Bruce Wayne. And then 5 is if the password change request for the end user, for this example was Bruce Wayne, was approved. So eventually, once he fulfilled the regular expression, it went straight through, it was approved, and it allowed him to log in with his new password. And I say, guys, hopefully you guys enjoyed this video, and I catch you guys on the next one. Peace out.